All right, guys, my name is Jacob, and when Kai asked me to speak today, I was very honored, so I appreciate that. As soon as he asked me to talk, I was like, oh, I gotta write some things down, I gotta make some points, what am I gonna talk about? You know, I've done that before, I've had talks and put together pictures and music and everything, and just like, you know, made something cool to put on the internet. So as I was thinking that, I got this immediate message from Spirit say, not today. We're not going to do that today. We're not going to make points. You're not going to write anything down, and you're not going to be nervous about it. Just let it go. It's like, all right, done. So I said, so what do I talk to them about? And I got the immediate message back is, you're going to tell them about their power. And I said, all right, that sounds good. And so all week long, I haven't thought about it. I just knew that we were going to talk about our power. And in the meditation this morning, I got an immediate message, very, very adamant about, tell them about your story. Tell them about your journey. How you were disempowered until you came to the state that you are now, where you are an empowered being. And I said, okay, I can do that. And it, you know, resonated with what you said earlier about, I just got into spirituality. And I was like, you really can't get into spirituality because you're already a spiritual being. Everybody is, you know? Everybody's a spiritual being, you know? We're inside these bodies, and we're spiritual beings having a human experience. We're not humans trying to have a spiritual being. So I said, okay, let's do it. Let's do a talk about the journey of being an empowered person to a power, to, you know, an empowered person, a powerful person. So I think just let's start at the beginning. As a little kid, I knew that something was wrong with the world. I knew that something was drastically wrong with adults. I went to school, I went to church, the preachers, the teachers, my mom, my dad. There was all something that I realized that they had drastically lost, but I couldn't put my finger on it. I didn't know what it was, but I knew that they had lost some kind of connection, something that made them, I don't want to say as intelligent, but I think the word is connection. They've lost something that they probably had at some point, but that I felt like I still had it in some way, and I didn't want to lose it, but I still didn't know what it was. Today, I would say they've lost their imaginations. They've lost their heart. People's hearts become hardened because someone told you, you can't be a dancer. You can't be whatever it is you want to be. Whatever it is you wanted to be as a kid. Those things that people tell you you can't be and you can't do. You need to find a safe job. You need to be an accountant. You need to go work for the government, whatever it is. Have a 401k. You know, those things, I think, we feel like we have to be safe. And we can't go live out our passions. So anyways, as a kid, I knew these things. I couldn't really put my finger on it. You go to church, you go to school. It's a lot of stuff that just doesn't make any sense. You know, it's just busy work, I felt like. And I was like, this is just nothing that, nobody's talked to me about anything that's empowered me. And no one said that. And so you go to school and you do those things. And, you know, all I knew was when I got out of high school that I was going to college to get away from my mom and dad and to get away from my current state, to try to get somewhere different. And so that's what I did. You do a lot of partying and stuff because you just, you're lost, you know? I think you do a lot of things, sex, drugs, rock and roll, whatever it is, to fill up some voids in your life because no one gave you anything as a kid, for at least for me, that really like was something that I empowered me, something that made me feel whole. So you do a lot of those things, and I spent 8 years of college for a four-year degree just because I was comfortable, and I had made it to like this level of working at a bar and being cool, and people knew who you were, and you didn't want to let that go, so I stayed in college for a long time. But along the way, you learn things and you grow, and there are things that I remember that was a big dot on the spiritual path for me. I remember being attracted to certain things. I was in my dorm room one time, and I was flipping through the History Channel, or the cable, and hit the History Channel, and comes on TV, and I'm just like, don't know what it is, but I'm like, this dude, I gotta watch this. I'm so attracted to this. And I remember like going and locking the door, and I could do anything in my fraternity room, and you know, no one would care. But I didn't want anybody to walk in on me watching my spiritual stuff. You know, watching the, I didn't even consider it spiritual at that point. You know, I just was like, it's 2000, 2001. I'm just like, I'm gonna watch this because I'm just so attracted to it. I can't not. And those kind of things were like really big for me. I just remember having those experiences where things would happen, and I was like, it's not a coincidence, you know? There's certain things that are manifesting. With people that you meet, people's names, birthdays, and events, and things like that, that were starting to like come together. And I started to ask more questions, especially when I got to college. One of the things that really woke me up, I remember being, I took intro to everything, philosophy, history, psychology. I didn't know what I wanted to be when I was a kid. My dad used to always ask me, what is it you want to be when you grow up? And my brother was like, I want to be in the military, I want to be a firefighter, I want to be a police officer. And I was like, those are great things, but those are not what I came here for. I don't know what it is I came here for, but I can tell you dozens of things that I didn't come here for. And that's knowing too, right? That's knowing something too, that what you not want to do is knowing too. So I feel like my whole life I've been searching for something. And so as you get older, I was in that psychology class, and the teacher says something to the effect of on the first day, jealousy is something that you feel because you put your thoughts into someone else's body. And that was like the first time someone said anything in class or church or something that was like, whoa, whoa, now that I can dig. That makes sense to me, you know, that I'm jealous because of what I feel I would do in that person's situation. So if I think you're going to cheat, it's because I would do that. And I was like, wow, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So I became a psychology major at that point, and decided how people thought was extremely attractive to me, and I wanted to know more about why people thought the way they did, and came up with their own ideas and stuck to certain things. And so I went with that. Fast forward to getting out of college, I remember, you know, that day when it was time to graduate, and I was like, all right, man, I'm going to graduate today. I've got this degree. I, you know, go out there and do something with it. I'm not exactly sure yet still. But then I had this, like, really sense of, it's not it. Still not it. $40,000 degree. That's not it. I was still missing something. So I remember looking up to the universe that day and be like, I don't know what it is, but I know there's something more than paying bills, getting a job, going to school, religion, politics. And I said to myself, I will make it my life's journey to figure that out, whatever it is. I don't care if it's Jesus, Buddha, atheism, whatever. I am open to everything, and I will read everything, and I will go through every nook and cranny to find something. You know, I don't know what it is I'm supposed to find, but I knew that day that I was supposed to find something. So after that point, I think that's when my intuition really just kicked in, and I started hearing, you know, people say voices, but when the voice is, it was a voice that was just loud and clear. It started to get louder and louder and louder, and it would tell me things like, today, read an alchemy book. Let's dive into Native American history. Let's read about the Mahabharata. Let's read the Gnostic Gospels. And I was hungry, man. I just read it all, and I looked at everything. And I remember one day in particular, reading an alchemy book, and I was like five chapters in, and this voice said to me loud and clear in my head, it was like, now read the Bible. And I'd read the Bible. I mean, I grew up in a Christian home where we went to church every Wednesday, every Sunday. And I thought Jesus was cool. He was a cool guy. I was like, man, this guy, I like him, you know what I mean? But I don't dig what you guys are saying about him. Like, there's a lot of confusion there for me. You know, God's angry and jealous in the Old Testament, and then God's love in the New Testament. It's kind of hard to be both at the same time, you know? Like, so I was confused about it, but I was all about Christ, you know, as this leader of spirituality, turning tables over, you know, being on the side of love and all those things. And so I remember reading the Alchemy book, about five chapters in, and it said, read the Bible. And I was like, the Bible is a big book. Where do I start? And then the voice just got louder and more definite. It was, read it, read it, read it, read it, read it. And I was like, all right, all right. I just opened it up, literally opened the Bible up somewhere in the middle, and I read, started reading a page, and then the sentence came up that was separated by space, in quotation marks, separated by space, and the sentence was basically, the cornerstone that the first builder rejected, and that was the exact same sentence, almost word for word, what I just read in the Alchemy book, and there was another sentence after that said the same thing, that was in the Alchemy book, and I was just like, now how could alchemy something that Christianity has to do with? And as soon as I asked that question, man, it was like I didn't see anything with my eyes, but I felt a whole nother world around me. I felt angels, I felt spirits, and they were all around me. And it was almost, and it was like your spirit family, you know? It's like the grandmother presence, the grandfather, aunts and uncles had passed away. You just felt this incredible reunion with all of them. And it was almost like they just started clapping for me. They were just like, oh, we got him. He's got it now. He's on the right path. And I just start bawling, you know, and you just start crying. And that's when I felt it. I felt unconditional love. I felt what I could only say is God's presence. That I would say Isaac Newton to Albert Einstein to Buddha to Krishna to Christ have all talked about nirvana experiences. And I felt it. I was there. I was everything that there was. I was loved for all the crappy things that I did, all the lies that I told, the cheating that I had done, everything that I had ever done wrong. I knew that it was fine. I knew that I was forgiven. And I knew at that moment, I was like, I am on the right path. And I never was off the path, you know. I just didn't recognize where I was at, you know. And I think it's all contrast. There's dark and there's light, and you go forth and you are always on the spiritual. Moment I knew that I was on a spiritual journey. And so I started doing things. I started meditating. I started doing yoga. And this all went along with the scientific, you know, being a psychologist, I was like, science shows that the brain lights up like a Christmas tree during meditation. So I said, let's do it, you know. So one of the first things I did was I was studying Dr. Emoto. I don't know if any of you guys have ever heard of him, but he was a Japanese scientist. He died a couple years ago. And he basically put words. rings around the center, you know, like throwing a pebble in the water, and then the rings come from that afterwards. And so, you know, I'm like, oh, wow, that's super cool. And then, you know, I get up from the meditation and walk into my living room and just happen to turn TV on. The channel that it's on is saying that exact same thing at the time. Exactly. The center of the galaxy is black hole. And I'm just like, whoa, that's cool. And so these synchronicities started to happen to me. People started to come into my life, places. I was sick when I was about 20 years old. I got an autoimmune disease. And even, let's go back, even before that, before we get to the autoimmune disease, when I was a kid, I was the happiest dude I had ever met, and I couldn't believe it. I was like, how does this guy have four different types of cancer and he is so happy? It was beyond me. And so I think because of that, though, like, you want to do better, you want to give him more of your energy, you want to like heal this guy, right? And so I remember one day him coming in, and he had just had chemotherapy. He also did, you know, science, medicine, the modern that's on the table. I got my hands out, and I'm just allowing spirit to come through the top of my head, through my body, out my hands, and just, you know, give them everything we had. And so we're doing it, and all of a sudden, it was like he walked up, and I'm in Jesus. I mean, like, it felt like Christ. I didn't see it, but it was like he walked up, and he was like 5 feet from me. And you felt it. It was the most incredible presence I'd ever felt in my whole life at the time. And I didn't know what was going to happen at first, but then he started walking up, and it started to get overwhelming, and you're like, holy moly, like, this is, I mean, it was every emotion you could possibly think of all at once, and you're just like, something's about to happen. And then as he got closer and closer and closer, all of a sudden, he walked into me. Like, that presence walked into my entire being, and I lost it, and I started bawling, crying. And there was another girl across from me, and she ran out the door and left the room. And I just assumed that I freaked her out, you know, that she was freaked out because of the situation. But I couldn't do it. I wasn't in control, so I'm just, like, crying and giving it to him. And this goes on for probably 45 seconds, but it felt like 4,500 years that we were sitting there. And then all of a sudden, I just remember someone kind of, like, tapping me and, like, all right, you know, let's sit over here for a little bit. And so I sat down there, calmed down and relaxed. And then after a while, they were all, like, asking me, What happened there? And I was like, dude, you guys wouldn't believe me if I told you. They're like, you're going to tell us. And I was like, all right. So I told him, I was like, the only way I can even put it into words is that Christ's presence was there and started to walk up. And then the other girl walked in and she said, oh my God, Jacob, that's what I felt too, but I couldn't handle it. It was too much for her. So she left the room. And I was like, the fact that I even put that into words and someone else, like, thought it was the same thing. It was incredible, you know? So those things have started to happen. And so I started to realize, like, man, I'm just a dude from Athens, Georgia, who's a bartender, who's been running away from who he was his whole life. Why am I having these experiences, you know? I'm really nobody. And that's how I thought, that's who I thought it was. I was like, why is this happening to me? And then, you know, as you go on and more things happen, and you start to have these feelings and happen to you, you realize, well, even Jesus said, you can do all the things I'm doing and greater things. How come we don't? How come we don't heal people with our hands? How come we don't walk on water? How come we don't do the things that the Buddhas and the Krishnas and the Allahs did, you know? How come we only heard about the resurrection story of Christ when there's 180,000 stories of Tibet of people who walked into heaven and their clothes fell to the ground? How come we didn't hear about that? How come no one told you that you're God? How come no one told you that you are a soul and a body having a human experience? Because they didn't know. They didn't know who they were. And so they just passed down this information that they've got, your parents and your teachers and your preachers, over and over and over again, until we think this stuff is fact. But they didn't know. They forgot too. We're just Jacob Cox from Athens, Georgia. You're white, you're black, you're a boy, you're a girl. It's just experiences that we have. And the more and more of those synchronicities happen to me, the more and more I went to the things that I was supposed to, you know? And it was hard because a lot of times I was like, all right, it's time to go to yoga now. I realized, like, oh, yoga's something you should do. It's going to further your spirituality. And so I was looking, I was talking to my roommates, hey, man, you guys, let's go to yoga together. And they wouldn't go, you know? And I was like, I know I'm supposed to go to yoga. Like, you guys should go. We're all going to learn something big. They weren't ready for that step yet. I was supposed to go to yoga. And that's what I realized, too, is if you're supposed to go to yoga, go. Don't wait for someone to go with you. Just go. You'll find other people doing yoga there that you'll be friends with, that you'll connect with. So I started to go. And one of the first times I did yoga, I was in the child's pose. And all of a sudden, I got real, real centered. And then, pow, I went through a wormhole, my consciousness did, and I was all of a sudden, zoop, in my living room as a kid, in the exact same pose. And I was like, whoa. But I'm me, you know, I'm 25-year-old, 26-year-old me at the time. doing that pose in the living room, my mom walks in and she looks at me and she kind of laughs a little bit. She goes, what are you doing in here? And I was like, I felt a little embarrassed all of a sudden. Because I was doing it because it felt good to me. I didn't know what yoga was as a kid, but I knew that felt good. And so because I got embarrassed, because I let her thoughts of what I was doing all of a sudden override what I thought was good and what I should do in my life, I stopped doing it. And I realized that was a pivotal moment in my process of evolution. That the minute I was worried that somebody else's opinion of what I was doing that felt good to me mattered, I lost something. I lost it. Lost something big. The minute you care about what someone else thinks about your journey, you lose something big in your life. You lose that direction. You lose that spiritual connection. And so I only assumed that that wormhole moment was me going back and getting it back. I reclaimed it. I took back that worry, and I said, I don't care what anybody thinks anymore. If this is good for me, it's good for me. I'm going to do it. So I went back to that moment. I got that back, and I go back to the mat, regular time. We finish up the class, and I was like, man, that was crazy. I didn't tell nobody about it. You know, just like, that's for me, you know? And I walk out into my car, and I'm feeling good. I was like, that was crazy, but it was super cool. And I start driving, and then all of a sudden, waterworks, boom. My heart opened up, and I started crying. And I started crying, and I felt that again, that unconditional love feeling of God's presence come in and say, you're on it. You're on the right path. You're doing it, man. This is what it's all about. It's about healing. Healing the traumas. Forgiving yourself. Forgiving others for judging you, you know? My mom did. That's not what she meant to do. It's just how culture had brought people up to, you know, kind of question, what are you doing different? Why are you doing something different than what we've been told, you know? But I got that back, and I reclaimed that, and it felt super good. And so, I realized at that moment that I was doing things that I was supposed to do, and I was leading by my intuition. Finally, I was going after the yoga, I was going after the meditations. I had got into some other things, you know. You find out, you realize that there are medicines, plant medicines to get into. I got into some of those. And that kind of stuff. And then one moment, one night, with DMT, everything changed. And I realized that day that I was going to quit a 4-day job where I made well over $1,000 in cash every week, working like 4 days a week. A good, safe job for me. It was easy. I'd done it for over a decade. But I knew that I was going to move to Colorado and work with kids in some capacity. And my brain was like, that's stupid. Why would you do that? That doesn't make any sense. That calculation, you know, what are you gonna do? Start over? Who's gonna hire a bartender to work with kids? I was like, I don't know, man. I don't know. I know it sounds stupid, but my heart says that's what I'm supposed to do, because my heart had opened up, you know, and it was like speaking to me loud and clear. And I was like, all right, I'm gonna do it. And so, but I knew about the law of attraction. I knew that I was gonna get what I believed I was gonna get. And so I started. I said, all right, how do I start this process? Saving money. So I started saving money. Started giving things away. So I started giving away my possessions. I started giving away things that meant something to me to people that meant to me, you know, were big in my life. So I started giving away my, you know, things. I was like, I'm only going to take what I can fit in my Jeep. And so I started giving things away. I sold things for really cheap TVs and stuff like that just to make a little extra money. And, you know, I knew the time was coming. The time was coming. And it's funny too, I had just got a raise. I asked my boss for a raise right before that, and I got it. And so I was making even more money than I was making before. And so things were good. But I knew that something was great beyond what I could see with my own eyes, what I could, you know, with my own intuition. So I packed up everything, I gave away everything I owned to move across the country, to work with kids, and I did a little traveling before I finally looked for that job. But basically, out of all the things I could find working with kids, there was only one job that, like, I felt like I even had a shot at. And I went, and it was working with autistic kids. And I didn't even know really what autism was besides a psychological disorder. So I went and did the interview. okay. I didn't have any credentials. I didn't have any resume for it. And they didn't call me back for a couple days. And then, you know, something happened with my car. I had to pay for it, and I had no money. So I remember sitting on the kitchen floor one day, and I got on my hands and knees, and I looked at the universe and said, okay, I am at the bottom of the barrel. I have nothing left. I followed everything that you said to follow, and now I have nothing. And I was like, I need that job. And it was like for $10 an hour. You know, it was nothing. And I got the call that day that they wanted me to come work. And I was like, all right, thank you for that. I appreciate that. So we started to go. And I swear to God, it was the hardest thing I'd ever done. Working with autistic kids in a center was the hardest thing I'd ever done. So there was at one point where I'm sitting at a desk with my hardest kid, and he's biting me and spitting me in the face. And I just remember taking a moment to look at the universe and be like, why? You know, didn't you direct me to this? Isn't like this is like what I thought I was supposed to do. Why is this so hard? And instantly I got the message back that, don't you think like Jesus was spat on? Don't you think Martin Luther King went to jail? Don't you think they were hit and they were punched? Want something big, right? You want to wake up the world. You want to be someone who's a revolutionary of love. If you can't take it from kids, how are you going to take it from adults? And I was like, man, that's heavy and it's deep, but it's so right. And I was like, okay, let's do it. And then I just remember like, all right, let's get the board out and let's go. And so like I was like determined at that point, no matter what they threw at me, I was going to forgive. And that, you know, I realized what it means to turn the other cheek, what it really means to have unconditional love for people, and to allow someone to be where they are right now, even an autistic kid, let him be where he's at. The best I could do is be calm and love him and send him energy and allow him to get through what he's got. And when I realized that I could be calm during this chaos, that it allowed him to be calm, right? And that if I was anxious and I was scared and I was worried, that made it worse. So I had to really control my own energy. And that became very powerful. Learning unconditional love, not just for others, but for myself, forgiving myself. All of those things really helped me realize how powerful I was. If I could forgive myself of all the crappy things I had done, it was so easy to forgive others of what they had done to me or what I thought that they had done that was wrong. So forgiving myself, yeah, time. Forgiving myself, loving myself, realizing that I was a powerful being in the universe, and that's what mattered. That not what someone else told me they thought about me or what I looked like, what color I was, whether I was male or female, none of that mattered. What mattered is I was a soul encompassing a body, and that I was powerful beyond my wildest dreams. And I believe every single one of us is that. And now I go throughout my life realizing that everybody's God. Every second, the wind blowing through our hair, every moment is sacred. And if we treat it like that, if we realize that, if we treat each other with respect at the workplace, at the drum circle, in the bathroom, that matters. Not the President of the United States making laws. Each of us is a small component, you know, a wave upon the ocean of existence. All of us are super important. All of us collectively make God together. And so that each of us, as we wake up to our divine power and realize this and put it into play. You know, there's that famous quote that today I'm clever because I wanted to change the world. But tomorrow I'll be wise when I realize I want to change myself. When you change yourself, when you forgive yourself, when you love yourself, that's stop talking about what's wrong with the world. Stop saying, I don't want the president to do this. I don't like this. I don't like that. Start telling the universe what you love. Start getting engulfed with what matters. You know, instead of saying, really hate oil being used and fossil fuels being burned. Start saying, I really love free energy. I really love solar power. I really love the solutions and not the problems. The problems give rise to solutions. They give us the platform to change. So
in this present moment, we give thanks. Drop in to whatever space, whatever temple in your heart, this unconditional.